Okey diyoruz en son. Ne oldu? Ejderha geldi. Interlude oldu. İşte tam orayı konuştuk zaten. Oraya hiç girmiyorum. Ondan sonra tekrar hikaye geri döndük. Dena şokta resmen. Oha! Düpedüz bir ejderha var karşımızda falan. Quote dedi ki ejderha değil o falan. Sonra Dena böyle deli gibi gülmeye başladı falan. Görmüyor musun? Şuna bak kocaman falan. Bir şeyler yaptı. Quote dedi ki ejderha değil o. Dragon değil, Dracus dedi. Hani böyle biliyor görüyorsunuz kelimeler benziyor ama aynı şey değiller falan. Dracus'un farkı neymiş Dragon'dan? Dracus işte şey, otçul, etçili değil, bunları yenme tehlikesi yok ama yanlışlıkla ezilebilirler falan. Sonra aklıma bir şey daha geldi benim kitabı okurken. Hani şimdi biz biraz kötü bir örnek olacak ama tutarlı bir örnek olacak bence. Hani diyelim çorba içiyoruz, çorbanın içine sinek kaçmış yanlışlıkla. Fark etmeden biz o çorba içmeye devam ediyoruz. Sinek yemiş oluyoruz. Aslında ama sinek yiyen bir şey değiliz. İnsan hani Türkler sinek yemiyor. Çinliler falan yiyor mu bilmiyorum da. Neyse aynı hesap bu da kocaman bir şey. Otçul eyvallah ama yanlışlıkla etçil olabilir. Ağacın üstünde yaşayan kuşları da yiyor çünkü mesela. Yanlışlıkla falan. Bu açıdan onun işte etçil olmayışını söylemek rahatlatıcı bir şey olabilir. Eyvallah. Sonuçta senin kokunu aldığı zaman hop senin peşinden koşmaya başlamayacak. Ama öte yandan hala çok tehlikeli. Yanlışlıkla seni yiyebilir falan çünkü diyoruz. Okey. Şu açıdan önemli. Bu şu an Kvot'un hikayesini yazan Chronicler neydi senin adın? Davos Seachi gibi bir şeydi sanki. Emin olamadım. Drakuslar üstüne meşhur bir kitabı var. Kvot da o kitabı okudu falan. Bu bir şekilde önemli olacak. Hani Chronicler şu an Kvot'un hikayesini yazan kişinin yazdığı bir kitabın ana karakteri, ana canavarı, ana yaratığı aşırı önemli bir konumda şu an. Kitabın sonlarına yaklaştık. Büyük olaylar gerçekleşiyor şu an. Ejderha çıktı falan işte. Drakus, whatever. Yani bir önemi var. Şu an bilmiyorum. İleride görebiliriz. Daha ayrıntılı bir şekilde durum bu. Sonra ne oldu? İşte Dena'yla Kvot güldüler, müldüler. Sonra tekrar kendine geldiler. Sonra tekrar güldüler. Sonra tekrar sustular falan. En son işte Dena artık çok yoruldum, uyumam lazım yaptı. Ama işte battaniyemiz aşağıda kaldı. Burası da buz gibi falan dedi. Cidden üşüdüğünü Kvot görebildi hani. Kvot dedi ki istiyorsan aşağı inip battaniyeyi alalım falan yaptı. Hayır, saçma sapan konuşma yaptı Dena. Sonra Kvot kendi şeyini çıkardı. Ne denir ona? Pelerin mi denir? Whatever. Onu çıkardı verdi. Dena aldı, uyumaya başladı. Kvot da Dena'yı izledi. İşte düşerse Dena'yı tutmak için çatçut falan diyoruz. Sonra orada bitti. Çok gereksizdi bence o bölüm. Kesişi niye bitiyorsun ki anlatmadan? Orada niye, siyah çizgi çekip yeni bir yer anlatmaya başlıyor tarzı falan bir şey yapabilirdi bence diyorum. Durum bu. Chapter 77. Bluffs demiş. I woke without remembering when I had fallen asleep. Then I was shaking me gently. Don't move too quickly, she said. It's a long way down. I slowly uncurled. Every muscle in my body complaining at how it had been treated yesterday. My thighs and calves were tight. Uşak tabii doğru düzgün uyumadı. Aşırı uzun bir mesafeyi atla geldi. Sonra koşturmaya cırt devam etti. Sonra Drakus gördü falan. Hani uyuması bile gerekmiyordu. Onun ayrı bir pişmanlığı varmıştır. Uyuyakalmış. Bütün vücudu ağrıyor falan. Tamam diyoruz. Hani resmen şeydeyiz şu an. Bunu karakterler yapmayı çok seviyor. Hani böyle karakter o kadar çok yoruluyor ki baş karakter falan biz hayatımızda hiç bu kadar yorulmadığımızı biliyoruz. Ve sonra onların o dinlenme zamanının geleceğini biliyoruz. Onlar da yatıp çok uzun süre uyuyacaklar falan. Öyle. My thighs and calves were tight. Hard knots of pain. Only then did I realize I was wearing my cloak again. Did I wake you up? I asked. Then I don't remember. In a way you did, she said. You know that often tipped right onto me. You didn't even flicker a lid when I cast you out. Ha böyle uyuyakalıp Dena'nın üstüne mi düşmüş? Tipped right on Tommy sanırım. Dena trailed off as she watched me slowly come to my feet. Good Lord, you look like someone's arthritic grandfather. You know how it is, I said. You're always stiff as when you wake up. She smirked. We women folk don't have that problem as a rule. Ha, bir dakika, bir dakika. Her expression grew serious as she watched me. Sirius Orange yiyor. Bir dakika, bu şu an şeyden bahsediyor. Şöyle genel bir olay var. Ben onu biliyorum. Erkeklerde oluyor bu. Uyandıkları zaman tuvaletleri olmuş oluyor. Ufak tuvaletleri. İdrar. İdrar baskıladığı için, baskı yaptığı için falan erekte olmuş bir şekilde kalkıyor. Erkekler genelde çok yaygın bir şey bu. Bundan mı bahsediyorlar? Başka bir şeyden mi emin olamadım. Okey, anlattım. Utanırım anlatamam diye düşünüyordum, anlatabildim ama. Sorun yok diyorum. I wrote about 60 miles yesterday before I met up with you, I said. I'm not really used to that. And when I jumped last night, I hit the rock pretty hard. Are you hurt? Absolutely, I said. Especially in my everywhere. Oh, she gasped. Her hands going to her mouth. Your beautiful hands. I looked down and saw what she meant. O beautiful hands, beautiful hands. Ne biçim eller var da beautiful oluyor? Anlamıyorum ki kanka diyoruz. Kimse bana beautiful hand de öyle. Tamam, okey. I looked down and saw what she meant. I must have hurt them rather badly in my wild attempt to climb the Greystone last night. My musicians, Caduceus had said my fingertips for the most part, but my knuckles were scraped badly and crossed with blood. Other parts of me hurt so much that I hadn't even noticed. My stomach clenched at the sight of them, but when I opened and closed my hands, I could tell they were just painfully skinned, not seriously injured. As a musician, I always worried that something might happen to my hands, and my work as an artificer had doubled that anxiety. It looks worse than it is, I said. How long has the Dracus been gone? I asked. At least a couple hours. It wandered away a little after the sun came up. I looked down from my high vantage on the Greystone Arch. Last evening, the hilltop had been a uniform expanse of green grass. This morning, it looked like a battlefield. The grass was crushed in places, burned to stubble in others. There were deep furrows dark in the earth where the lizard had rolled or dragged its heavy body across the turf. Getting down from the Greystone was harder than getting up had been. The top of the arch was about 12 feet off the ground, higher than was convenient for jumping. Normally, I wouldn't have worried about it, but in my stiff, bruised condition, I worried I'd land awkwardly and turn my ankle. Eventually, we managed it by using the strap of my travel sack as a makeshift rope. Ne olduydu? Tinker buna rope sana verebilirim tarzı bir anlaşma sunduydu. Bu reddettiydi. Tinker'ı reddetmeyeceksin diyoruz. But then I braced herself and had one end. I lowered myself down. The sack ripped wide open, of course, scattering my belongings, but I made it to the ground with nothing more serious than a grass stain. Then I hung from the lip of the rock and I grabbed her legs, letting her slide down slowly. Despite the fact that I was bruised all down my front side, the experience did a lot to improve my mood. I gathered up my things and sat down with needle and thread to sew my travel sack back together. After a moment, then I returned from her brief trip into the trees, pausing briefly to pick up the blanket we'd left below. It had several large claw rents from when the Dracus had walked over it. Have you ever seen one of these before? I asked, holding out my hand. She raised an eyebrow at me. How many times have I heard that one? Grinning, I handed her the lump of black iron I got from the tinker. She looked it over curiously. Is this a lodestone? I'm surprised you recognize it. I knew a fellow who used one as a paperweight, she sighed disparagingly. He made a special point of how, despite the fact that it was so valuable and exceedingly rare, he used it as a paperweight, she sniffed. He was a prat. Do you have any iron? Fish around in there, I pointed to my jumbled possessions. There is bound to be something. Then I sat on one of the lower graystones and played with a lodestone and a piece of broken iron bucket. I slowly sealed up my travel sack, then reattached the strap, stitching it several times so it wouldn't come loose. Then I was truly engrossed by the Loden's tongue. How does it work, she asked, pulling the buckle away and letting it snap back. Where does the pulling come from? It's a type of galvanic force, I said, then hesitated, which is a fancy way of saying that I got no idea at all. I wonder if it only likes iron because it's made of iron, she mused, touching her silver ring to it with no effect. If someone found a Loden stone made of brass, would it like other brass? Maybe it would like copper and zinc, I said. That's what brass is made of. Yine bilgiçlik taslıyor diyoruz. I turned the bag right side out and began picking up my things. Then I handed me back the Loden stone and wandered off toward the destroyed remains of the fire pit. It ate all the wood before it left, she said. I went over to look too. The area around the fire pit was a churned up mess. It looked like an entire legion of cavalry had ridden across it. I prodded a great piece of overturned sod turf with the toe of my boot, then bent to pick something up. Look at this. Then I came closer and I held something up for her to see. It was one of the Dracus's scales, smooth and black, roughly as big as my palm, and shaped like a teardrop. It was a quarter inch thick in the middle, tapering to the edges. I held it out to Dena for a human lady, a memento. She held it in her hand. It's heavy, she said. I go find one for you. She skipped back to prod through the remains of the fire pit. I think it ate some of the rocks along with the wood. I know I gathered more than this to line the fire last night. Lizards eat rocks all the time, I said. It's how they digest their food. The rocks cleaned up the food in their guts. Then I eyed me skeptically. It's true, chickens do it too. She shook her head, looked away as she prodded in the churned up earth. You know, at first I was kind of hoping you will turn this encounter into a song. But the more you talk about this thing, I'm not so sure. Cows and chickens, where is your flair for the dramatic? It does well enough without exaggeration, I said. That scale is mostly iron, unless I miss my guess. How can I make that more dramatic than it already is? She held up the scale, looking at it closely. You're kidding, I grinned at her. The rocks around here are full of iron, I said. The Dracus eats the rocks and slowly they get ground down in his gizzard. The metal slowly filters into the bones and scales. I took the scale and walked over to one of the gravestones. Year after year, it sheds its skin, then eats it, keeping the iron in its system. After 200 years, I tapped the scale against the stone. It made a sharp ringing sound somewhere between a bell and a piece of glazed ceramic. I handed it back to her. Back before modern mining, people probably hunted them for their iron. Even nowadays, I'm guessing an alchemist would pay a pretty penny for the scales or bones. Organic iron is a real rarity. They could probably do all sorts of things with it. Then I looked down at the scale in her hand. You win. You can write the song. Her eyes lit with an idea. Let me see the Loden stone. I dug it out of my bag and handed it to her. She brought the scale close to it and they snapped sharply together, making the same odd ceramic ring again. Okay, bu da enteresan bir nokta. O şu an bir şey fark ettim. Tamam. Dracus'un işte derisi demirden yapılıyor. Aynı zamanda Chronicler'ın demirin adını bildiğini de biliyoruz. Ne da fucking coincidence diyor yine. Daha da önemli olabilir. Ben bunu hiç fark etmediydim. Çünkü direkt burada işte Dracus'un derisi demirden diye okunduğunu falan hiç hatırlamıyordum ben. Okey diyoruz. Nerede benim masum? She brought the scale close to it and they snapped sharply together, making the same odd ceramic ring again. She grinned and walked back over to the fire pit and started pushing the lodestone through the debris, hunting for more scales. I looked out toward the northern bluffs. I hate to be the bearer of bad news, I said, pointing off to a faint smudge of smoke rising from the trees. But something's smoldering down there. The marker states I planted our gun, but I think that's the direction we saw the blue fire last night. Then I moved the lodestone back and forth over the ruins of the fire pit. The Dracus couldn't have been responsible for what happened at the Malden farm. She gestured at the churned up earth and salt. There wasn't any of this sort of wreckage there. I'm not thinking about the farm, I said. I'm thinking someone's patron might have been roughing it last night with a cheery little campfire. Dana's face fell. And the Draco saw it. I wouldn't worry, I said quickly. If he's as clever as you say, he's probably safe as houses. Show me a house that's safe from that thing, she said grimly, handing me back my lodestone. Let's go have a look. It was only a few miles to where the faint line of smoke rose from the forest, but we made bad time. We were sore and tired, and neither of us was hopeful about what we would find when we reached our destination. While we walked, we shared my last apple and half of my remaining loaf of flat bread. I cut strips of birch bark, and then I and I both picked at them and chewed. After an hour or so, the muscles in my legs relaxed to the point where walking was no longer painful. As we got closer, our progress slowed. Rolling hills were replaced with sharp bluffs and scree-covered slopes. We had to climb or go the long way around, sometimes doubling back before we found a way through. And there were distractions. We stumbled onto a patch of ripe ashberry that slowed us down for almost a full hour. Not long after, did we find a stream and stopped to drink and rest and wash. Again, my hope for a storybook deliverance was thwarted by the fact that the stream was only about 6 inches deep, not ideal for proper baiting. It was early afternoon before we finally came to the source of the smoke, and what we found was not at all what we expected. It was a secluded valley tucked into the bluffs. I say valley, but in truth it was more like a gigantic step among the foothills. On one side was a high cliff wall of dark rock, and on the other was a sheer drop off. Then I and I came at it from two different, unapproachable angles before we finally found a way in. Luckily, the day was windless and the smoke rose straight as an arrow into the clear blue sky. If not for that to guide us, we probably never would have found the place. Once it had probably been a pleasant little piece of forest, but now it looked like it had been struck by a tornado. Trees were broken, uprooted, charred, and smashed. Huge furrows of exposed earth and rock were dug everywhere, as if some giant farmer had gone raving mad while plowing his field. 2 days ago, I wouldn't have been able to guess what would cause such destruction. But after what I had seen last night, I thought you said they were harmless, and I said, turning to me, it went on a rampage here. Then I and I began to pick our way through the wreckage. The white smoke rose from the deep hole left by a large maple tree that had been tipped over. The fire was nothing more than a few coals smoldering in the bottom of the hole where the roots had been. I had idly kicked a few more clods of dirt into the hole with the toe of my boot. Well, the good news is that your patron isn't here. The bad news is, I broke off, drawing a deeper breath. Do you smell that? Then I took a deep breath and nodded, wrinkling her nose. I climbed up onto the side of the fallen maple and looked around. The wind shifted and the smell grew stronger, something dead and rotten. I thought you said they don't eat meat, Dana said, looking around nervously. I hopped down from the tree and made my way back to the cliff wall. There was a small log cabin there, smashed to flinders. The rotting smell was stronger. Okay, Dana said, looking over the wreckage. This does not look harmless at all. We don't know if the Dracus was responsible for this, I said. If the Chandrian attacked here, the Dracus could have been lured by the fire and caused the destruction by putting it out. You think the Chandrian did this? She asked. That doesn't fit with anything I've ever heard of. Damn, they're supposed to strike like lightning, then disappear. They don't visit, set some fires, then come back later to run a few errands. I don't know what to think, but two destroyed houses. I began to sift through the wreckage. It seems reasonable that they're related. Then I drew in a sharp breath. I followed her line of sight and saw the arm protruding from under several heavy logs. I moved closer. Flies buzzed up and I covered my mouth a bit in a futile attempt to stave off the smell. He's been dead for about 2 span. I bent and picked up a tangle of shattered wood and metal. Look at this. Bring it here and I'll look at it. I brought it back to where she stood. The thing was broken almost beyond recognition. Crossbow didn't do him much good, she said. The question is, why did he have it in the first place? I looked at the thick piece of blue steel that made the crossbar. This wasn't some hunting bow. This is what you use to kill a man in armor from across a field. They're illegal. Then I snorted. Those sorts of laws don't get enforced out here. You know that. I shrugged. The fact remains that this was an expensive piece of machinery. Why would someone living in a tiny cabin with a dirt floor own a crossbow worth 10 talents? Maybe he knew about the Dracus, then I said, looking around nervously. I wouldn't mind a crossbow right about now. I shook my head. Dracus are shy. They stay away from people. Then they gave me a frank look, gesturing sarcastically at the wreckage of the cabin. Think about every white creature in the forest, I said. All white creatures avoid contact with people. Like you said, you never even heard of the Dracus. There is a reason for that. Maybe it's rabbit. That brought me up short. That's a terrifying thought. I looked around at the ruined landscape. Rabbit derken kuduz gibi bir şey diyor. Sanırım diyoruz. Aynen. I looked around at the ruined landscape. How on earth would you put something like that down? Can a lizard even catch the frost? Derken bu da virüsün adı sanırım. Bir bakalım yine de. Köpük. Aynen. MS of small bubble jet trip bu değil. Form or container rising or overflowing mass of small bubbles. Neyse diyoruz. Then I shifted uncomfortably from one foot to the other, looking around nervously. Is there anything else you'd like to look at here? Because I am done with this place. I don't want to be here when that thing gets back. Part of me feels like we should give this fellow a decent burial. Then I shook her head. I am not staying here that long. We can tell someone in town and they can take care of it. It could come back any minute. But why? I asked. Why does it keep coming back here? I pointed. The tree's been dead for a span of days, but that one just got torn up a couple days ago. Why do you care? Then I asked. The Chandrian, I said firmly, I want to know why they were here. Do they control the Dracus? I don't think they were here, then I said. At the modern farm, maybe, but this is just the work of a rabbit called Lizard. She gave me a long look, searching my face. I don't know what you came here looking for, but I don't think you're going to find it. I shook my head, looking around. I feel like this has to be connected to the farm. I think you want it to be connected, she said gently, but this fellow's been dead a long while. you said it so yourself. And remember the door frame and the water threw at the farm. She bent down and rapped a knuckle against one of the logs from the ruined cabin. It made a solid sound. And look at the crossbow. The metal isn't rusted away. They weren't here. I felt my heart sink in my chest. I knew she was right. Deep down, I knew I'd been grasping at straws. Still, it felt wrong giving up without trying everything possible. Then I took hold of my hand. Come on, let's go. She smiled and tugged on me. Her hand was cool and smooth in my own. There is more interesting things to do than hunt, derken. There was a loud splintering noise off in the trees. Falan, direkt şeyin sesi diyoruz, Drakus'un. Then I dropped my hand and turned to face the wave with calm. No, she said, no, no, no. The sudden tread of the Drakus brought me back into focus. You're fine, I said, looking around. It can't climb, it's too heavy. Climb what? A tree? It's been knocking those down for fun. The plus, I pointed to the cliff wall that bordered this little section of forest. Come on. We scrambled to the base of the cliff, stumbling through furrows and jumping over fallen trees. Behind us, I heard the rumbling, thunder-like grunt. I darted a glance over my shoulder, but the Drakus was still somewhere among the trees. We got to the base of the cliff and I started searching for a section both of us could climb. After a long frantic minute, we emerged from a thick patch of sumac to find a swath of widely churned up dirt. The Drakus had been digging there. Look, then I pointed to a break in the cliff, a deep crack about 2 feet across. It was wide enough for a person to squeeze through, but too narrow for the huge lizard. There were sharp claw marks on the cliff wall and broken rocks scattered around the churned up earth. Then and I squeezed into the narrow gap. It was dark, the only light coming from the narrow strip of blue sky high overhead. As I crept along, I was forced to turn sideways in places to make it through. When I brought my hands away from the walls, my palms were covered in black soot. Unable to dig its way in, apparently the Drakus had breathed fire down into the narrow passage. After only a dozen feet, the crevasse widened slightly. There is a ladder, then I said, I'm going up. If that thing breathes fire at us, it will be like rainwater down a gully. She climbed and I followed her. The ladder was crude but sturdy, and after 20 feet, it opened out onto a piece of level ground. Dark stone surrounded us on three sides, but there was a clear view of the ruined cabin and the destroyed trees below. A wooden box was set against a cliff wall. Can you see it? Then I asked, peering down. Tell me I didn't just kill my knees running from nothing. I heard a dull whomp and I felt a wave of hot air rise up against my back. The Drakus grunted again and another wash of fire ran through the narrow gap below. And there came a sudden furious sound like nails on a slate, as the Drakus clawed madly against the base of the cliff. Then it gave me a frank look, harmless. It's not after us, I said, you saw. It was digging at that wall long before we ever got here. Then I said, Dan, what is this place? Some sort of lookout, I said. You can see the whole valley from here. Obviously, it is a lookout, she sighed. I'm talking about the whole place. I opened a wooden box that was up against the cliff wall. Inside was a rough wool blanket, a full water skin, some dried meat, and a dozen wickedly sharp crossbow bolts. Very good, Diaz. I don't know either, I admitted. Maybe the fellow was a fugitive. The noise stopped below. Then and I peered out over the ruined valley. Eventually, the Drakus moved away from the cliff. It walked slowly, its huge body digging an irregular rut into the ground. It's not moving as quickly as it did last night, I said. Maybe it is sick. Maybe it's tired from a hard day's trying to track us down and kill us. She looked up at me. She looked up at me. Sit down. You're making me nervous. You're not going anywhere for a while. I sat down and we watched the Dracus make its plodding way to the middle of the valley. It ran up to a tree about 30 feet tall and pushed it over without any noticeable effort. Then it began to eat it, leaves first. Next, it crunched up branches thick as my wrist as easily as a sheep would tear up a mouthful of grass. When the trunk was finally stripped bare, I assumed it would have to stop, but it simply clamped its huge, flat mouth down on one end of the trunk and twisted its massive neck. The trunk splintered and broke, leaving the Dracus with a large but manageable mouthful that it bolted down more or less whole. Then and I took the opportunity to eat some lunch of our own, just some flatbread sausage and the rest of my carrots. I was hesitant to trust the food in the box, as there was a distinct possibility that the fellow living here had been some manner of crazy. It still amazes me that no one around here has ever seen it, then I said. People have probably caught glimpses, I said. The swineherd said, everyone knows there is something dangerous in these woods. They probably just assumed it was a demon or some nonsense like that. Then I glanced back at me, an amused curl to her mouth. Says the fellow who came to town looking for the Chandrian. That's different, I protested hotly. I don't go around spouting fairy stories and touching iron. I'm here so I can learn the truth, so I can have information that comes from somewhere more reliable than third-hand stories. I didn't mean to touch any nerve, then I said, taken aback. She looked back down below. It really is an incredible animal. When I read about it, I didn't really believe about the fire, I admitted. It seemed a little far-fetched to me. More far-fetched than a lizard big as a horse cart. That's just a matter of size. But fire isn't a natural thing. If nothing else, where does it keep the fire? It's obviously not burning inside. Didn't they explain it in that book you read? Then I asked. The other had some guesses, but that's all. He couldn't catch one to dissect it. Understandable, then I said, as she watched the Dracus casually nudge over another tree and begin eating that one as well. What sort of a net or a cage would hold it? He had some interesting theories, though, I said. You know how cow manure gives off a gas that burns? Then I turned to look at me and laughed. No, really? I nodded, grinning. Farm kids will strike sparks onto a fresh coal pot pad and watch it burn. That's why farmers have to be careful about storing manure. Organik gaz mı diyorduk biz buna? The gas can build up and explode. I'm a city girl, she said, chuckling. We didn't play those sorts of games. You missed some big fun, I said. The other suggested that the Dracus just stores that gas in a bladder of some kind. The real question is how it lies, I guess. The other has a clever idea about arsenic, which makes sense chemically. Arsenic and coal gas will explode if you put them together. That's how you get marsh lice in swamps. But I think that's a little unreasonable. If it had that much arsenic in its body, it would poison itself. Then I said, still watching the Dracus below. But if you think about it, all it needs is a tiny spark to ignite the gas, I said. And there are plenty of animals that can create enough galvanic force for a spark. Crab eels, for example, can generate enough to kill a man, and they're only a couple of feet long. I guess you're toward the Dracus, something that big could certainly generate enough for a spark. Okey, burası bayağı güzel. Ne açısından güzel? Gerçekten organik gaz gibisinden bir muhabbet var. Hatta bunu işte köylerde, ocaklarda cırcırt kullanma tarzı muhabbetlerin olduğunu biliyordum ben işte ne kadar aslında enerji kazanımına, tasarrufuna işte sebep olabilir tarzı laflar dönüyordu bir dönem. Hatırlamıyorum hangi dönem. Neyse artı biz hikayelerde biliyoruz ejderha ateş çıkarabiliyor. Hani hiçbir şekilde ejderhanın ya da ateşin kokusu hakkında hiç konuşmadıydık mesela. Ama eğer durum böyleyse benim organik gaz dediğim olay düpedüz zaten hayvan osurumu bayağı kötü kokuyordur diyoruz. Hani işin bir esprili tarafı oldu. Artı işin gerçek dünyaya bayağı bağlanabilir bir tarafı oldu. Artı hani direkt biyolojik olarak sanki mümkün dermiş gibi görünmeye başladı bu yaratıklar falan. Hani şu açıklamalar bayağı kaliteli yapıyor. Bu Drakus'u çünkü düpedüz ejderha gibi davranabilen büyük bir yaratıktan bahsediyor oluyoruz yani şu an. Very good. I was hoping that then I would be impressed by my ingenuity, but she seemed distracted by the symbol. Oh, you're not really listening to me, are you? Not so much, she said, turning to me and giving a smile. I mean, it makes perfect sense to me. It eats wood, wood burns. Why wouldn't it breathe fire? But I tried to think of a response to that. She pointed down into the valley. Look at the trees down there. Do they look odd to you? Aside from being destroyed and mostly eaten, I asked, not particularly. Look how they are arranged. It's hard to see because the place is a shambles, but it looks like they were growing in rows, like someone planted them. Now that she pointed it out, it did look like a large section of the trees had been in rows before the Dracus came. A dozen rows with a score of trees each. Most of them were now only stumps or empty holes. Why would someone plant trees in the middle of a forest? She mused. It's not an orchard. Did you see any fruit? I shook my head. And those trees are the only ones that Dracus has been eating, she said. There is a big clear spot in the middle. The others he knocks down, but those he knocks down and eats, she squinted. What kind of tree is it eating right now? I can't tell from here, I said. Maple? Does it have a sweet tooth? We looked for a while longer. Then I got to her feet. Well, the important thing is that it's not going to run over and breathe fire down our backs. Let's go see what's at the other end of that narrow path. I am guessing it's a way out of here. We headed down the ladder and made our slow, winding way along the bottom of the tiny crevasse. It twisted and turned for another 20 feet before opening up into a tiny box canyon, with steep walls rising away on every side. There was no way out, but it was obviously being put to some use. The place had been cleared of plants, leaving a packed dirt floor. Two long fire pits had been dug, and resting over the pits on brick platforms were large metal pans. They almost resembled the rendering beds that knackers use for tallow. But these were wide, flat, and shallow, like baking pans for enormous pies. It does have a sweet tooth, then I laughed. This fellow was making maple candy here or syrup. I moved closer to look. There were buckets lying around, of the sort that could carry maple sap so it could be boiled down. I opened the door of a tiny ramshackle shed and saw more buckets, long wooden paddles for stirring the sap, scrapers for getting it out of the pans. But it didn't feel right. There were plenty of maple trees in the forest. It didn't make sense to cultivate them. And why pick such an out-of-the-way place? Maybe the fellow was simply crazy. Idly, I picked up one of the scrapers and looked at it. The edge was smeared dark, like it had been scraping tar. Each, then I said behind me, bitter. I think they burned it. I turned around and saw Dana standing by one of the fire pits. She had pried a large disc of sticky material out of the bottom of one of the pans and taken a bite out of it. It was black, but a deep amber color of maple candy. I suddenly realized what was really going on here. Don't. She looked at me, puzzled. It's not that bad, she said. Her words muffled through her sticky mouthful. It's strange, but not really unpleasant. I stepped over to her, knocked it out of her hand. O kadar enteresan bir cümle ki beynim algılayıp alamadı. Şöyle bir bakıp geliyorum. Devam. Her eyes flashed angrily at me. Spit it out, I snapped. Now it's poison. Her expression went from angry to terrified in a flash. She opened her mouth and let the wet of dark stuff fall to the ground. Then she spat, her saliva thick and black. I pressed my water bottle into her hands. Rinse your mouth out, I said. Rinse and spit it out. She took the bottle, and then I remembered it was empty. We'd finished it during lunch. I took off running, scrambling through the narrow passage. I darted up the ladder, grabbed the water skin, then down and back to the small canyon. Then I was sitting on the canyon floor, looking very pale and wide-eyed. I thrust the water skin into her hands, and she gulped so quickly that she choked, then gagged a bit as she spat it out. I reached into the fire pit, pushing my hand deep into the ashes until I found the unburned coals underneath. I brought up a handful of unburned charcoal. I shook my hand, scattering most of the ashes away, then thrust a handful of black coals at her. Eat this, I said. She looked at me blankly. Do it. I shook the handful of coals at her. If you don't chew this up and swallow it, I'll knock you out and force it down your throat. I put some in my own mouth. Look, it's fine. Just do it. Şu bence harika bir hareket şuradaki. My tone softened, became more pleading than commanding. Dana, trust me. She took some coals and put them in her mouth. Face pale and eyes beginning to brim with tears, she gritted up a mouthful and took a drink of water to wash it down, grimacing. They're harvesting goddamn of all of here, I said. I'm an idiot for not seeing it sooner. Then I started to say something, but I cut her off. Don't talk. Keep eating as much as you can stomach. She nodded solemnly, her eyes wide. She chewed, choked a little, and swallowed the charcoal with another mouthful of water. She ate a dozen mouthfuls in quick succession. Very fucking good diyoruz. Akma Daenerys Targaryen'in at kalbi yediği sahne geldi. Then rinsed her mouth out again. What's a follow, she asked softly. A truck. Those are dinner trees. We just had a whole mouthful of dinner resin. Dinner resin, Dana isimler benziyor diyoruz. Bu fikir benden değil, Joe'dan çıktı. Bir alakası olabilir. Hani belki kvotun bağımlılığı falan diyoruz. Ama diyoruz gerçekten eşittir birine bağımlı olmak mı kanka? Biraz take it easy falan yapıyoruz. Kvota artı Patrick Rothfuss'a. But we shall see. Belki de başka bir kastı varmıştır. Patrick Rothfuss'un Dana ile diyoruz. Okay. I sat down. Ama aşkın ne olduğunu biliyorum ve Kvot'un kullandığı kelimeler kesinlikle aşktan bahsediyor. Bu açıdan Dana enteresan bir karakter. Hani bir yandan bir sapkınlıkmış gibi geliyor Kvot'un hissettikleri. Hani bir yandan doğru gelmiyor bu Dana karakteri. Ama bir yandan Kvot'un Dana hakkında söylediği şeyler kesinlikle aşk. We shall see diyor. We shall see. I sat down next to her. My hands were shaking. I laid them flat against my legs to hide it. She was quiet at that. Everyone knew about Dana resin. In Tarbin, the neckers had to come for the stiff bodies of sweet eaters that overdosed in the dark side alleys and doorways. How much did you swallow, I asked. I was just chewing it like taffy. Her face went pale again. There's still some stuck in my teeth. I touched the water skin. Keep rinsing. She swished the water from cheek to cheek before spitting and repeating the process. I tried to guess at how much of the drug she'd gotten into her system, But there were too many variables. I didn't know how much she had swallowed, how refined this resin was, if the farmers had taken any steps to filter or purify it. Her mouth worked as her tongue felt around her teeth. Okay, I'm clean. I forced a laugh. You're anything but clean, I said. Your mouth is all black. You look like a kid that's been playing in the coal bin. You aren't much better, she said. You look like a chimney sweep. She reached out to touch my bare shoulder. I must have torn my shirt against the rocks in my rush to get the water skin. She gave a wan smile that didn't touch her frightened eyes at all. Why do I have a belly full of coals? Karkovil is like a chemical sponge, I said. It soaks up drugs and poisons. She brightened a little, all of them. I considered lying, then thought better of it, most. You got it into you pretty quickly. It will soak up a lot of what you swallowed. How much? About 6 parts in 10, I said. Hopefully a little more. How do you feel? Scared, she said, shaky, but other than that, no different. She shifted nervously where she sat and put her hand on the sticky disc of resin I'd knocked away from her earlier. She flicked it away and wiped her hand nervously on her pants. How long will it be before we know? I don't know how much they refined it, I said. If it's still raw, it will take longer to work its way into your system, which is good, as the effects will be spread out over a longer period of time. I felt for her pulse in her neck. It was racing, which didn't tell me anything. Mine was racing too. Look up here, I gestured with my raised hand and watched her eyes. Her pupils were sluggish, responding to the light. I lay my hand on her head, and under the pretext of lifting her eyelid a little, I pressed my finger against the blue vise on her temple, heart. She didn't flinch or show the least hint that it pained her. I thought I was imagining it before, then I said, looking up at me, but your eyes really do change color. Normally they're bright green with a ring of gold around the inside. I got them from my mother, I said, but I've been watching. When you broke the pump handle yesterday, they went dull green, muddy, and when the swineherd made that comment about the roof, they went dark for just a moment. I thought it was just the light, but now I can see it's not. I'm surprised you noticed, I said. The only other person to ever point it out was an old teacher of mine. O bunu şey ne zaman söyledi? Ben hatırlamıyorum ki. Abend. O şu Abend'i o kadar çok seviyorum ki. O kadar az gördük ki şu ana kadar ama şu kısım bile yetti yani. Okay. And he was an arcanist, which means it's pretty much his job to notice things. But it's my job to notice things about you. She cocked her head a bit. People probably are distracted by your hair. It's so bright, it's pretty, pretty distracting. And your face is really expressive. You're always in control of it, even the way your eyes behave, but not the color. She gave a faint smile. They're pale now, like green frost. You must be terribly afraid. I'm guessing it's old-fashioned lust, I said in my roughest tones. It's not often a beautiful girl lets me get this close to her. You always tell me the most beautiful lies. Burada bir sürü yedi kelimeli cümle vardı. Bakacağım az sonra. She said, looking away from me and down to her hands. Am I going to die? No, I said firmly, absolutely not. Cold. She looked up at me and smiled again. Her eyes wet but not overflowing. Could you just say it out loud for me? Ama çok duygusal bir sahneymiş lan. O kadar hakaret ediyor mu ikisinin ilişkisine ama okay diyorum. O kadar da şey değilim ben de. Canavar. Okay. You aren't going to die, I said, getting to my feet. Come on, let's see if our lizard friend is gone yet. I wanted to keep her moving around and distracted, so we each had another little drink and headed back to the lookout. The dracos lay sleeping in the sun. I took the opportunity to stuff the blanket and the dried meat into my treble sack. I felt guilty about stealing from the dead before I said, but now, at least now we know why he was hiding in the middle of nowhere with a crossbow and a lookout and all that. Then I said, a minor mystery solved. I started to fasten up my treble sack. Then, as an afterthought, packed the crossbow bolts as well. What are those for, she asked. They're worth something, I said. I'm in debt to a dangerous person. I could use every penny. I traded off my mind working. Then I looked at me, and I could see her mind jumping to the same conclusion. Do you know how much that much resin would be worth, she asked. Not really, I said, thinking about the 30 pence, each with a wafer of black, sticky resin congealed in the bottom, big as a dinner plate. I'm guessing a lot, an awful lot. Then I shifted back and forth on her feet. Quote, I don't know how I feel about this. I seen girls get hooked on this stuff. I need money. She gave a bitter laugh. I don't even have a second set of clothes right now. She looked worried, but I don't know if I need it this badly. I'm thinking of apothecaries, I said quickly. They'd refine it into medicine. It's a powerful painkiller. The price won't be nearly as good as if we went to the other sort of people, but still half a loaf. Then I smiled broadly. I'd love half a loaf, especially since my cryptic prig of a patron seems to have disappeared. We headed back down into the canyon. This time, as I emerged from the narrow passageway, I saw the evaporating pans in a different light. Now, each of them was the equivalent of a heavy coin in my pocket. Next terms, tuition, new clothes, freedom from my debt with Devi. I saw Dana looking at the trays with the same fascination. Aklıma bir şey geldi. Bu Devi'nin kvota benzemesinden ben bahsettiydim size, hatırlıyorum. Bast'a devil gibi davranı kronikler aslında Bast'ın devil olmadığından bahsettik. Ama bir yandan Bast demirlerden çekiniyor ve halkta bir söylence var. Demirler şeytanları korkutuyor. Cedjurt. Kvot'un gözlerinin rengi değişiyor ki insanlarda olan bir özellik değil bu. Devi Kvot'a benziyor. Kvot Devi gibi bir şey. Devi'de de L dışında bütün harfler var. Devil'ı anlatan. Kvot Feiri gibi bir sonuca varıyor burada. Kötü anlattım ama anlatabildim bence. I saw Dana looking at the trees with the same fascination, though hers was somewhat more glassy-eyed than mine. I could live comfortably for a year off this, she said, and not be beholden to anyone. I went to the tool shed and grabbed a scraper for each of us. At the end of a few minutes' work, we had combined all of the black, sticky pieces into a single wad the size of a sweet melon. Okay, bana ayrılan sürenin sonuna geldik. Şuradan devam edeceğim. Diyecek de bir şeyim yok. Kendinize iyi bakın. Görüşürüz.